and casting himself down before the house of God, there assembled unto him out of Israel a very great congregation of men and women and children, for the people wept very sore. Sometimes we have to learn how to cry together.
Yes,
when you hurt, I hurt. When I hurt, you hurt. Guess what? When we learn how to have empathy, when we learn how to have sympathy, when we learn how to feel for one another, we'll be stronger. Not only will we be stronger, we'll be better for it as well. Watch my time here. And so watch this. He says in Shekinah, the son of Jehiel and the sons of Elam answered and said unto Ezra, he said, we have trespassed against our God and have taken strange wives of the people of the land. Yet now there is hope in Israel concerning these things. Sometimes our biggest problem is our own household. Sometimes our biggest problem is what's going on in our household. Sometimes our biggest problem is that we're unequally yoked in the household or not yoked at all in the household. And so in times like these, what is God's children supposed to do? We're supposed to get back to the word of God. And so watch what he says in verse number 4. He said, arise, for this matter belongeth unto thee. We also will be with thee. Be of good courage and do it. It's good to know when folk are on your team. It's good to know when you're on God's team. Because he says, be of good courage and do it. See, this is not a matter that should be taken, that would be taken care of overnight. And that's one of our problems now. Some of us in our household, some of us in our families, and in our society, we feel like that we pray for something, or we feel like that we address the issue, and we want it to be taken care of overnight. It don't work that way. Did it get that way overnight? If it didn't get that way overnight, it's not going to get back to where it needs to be overnight, all right? But we have to address it. We have to address it. If we don't address it, guess what, church? It's going to get worse and worse. Some of y'all know that church is not all that I do. That my secular life, that I work as a bank manager. And I had fun telling this because I was at work one day, and I told my wife about it. A young lady, she came into work, and she barely had anything on, Doc. And as she's standing where the desk was pretty much up in front of the teller station. And while you sitting at the desk, she walked in with nothing on at all, barely with anything on. And right across the bottom there, y'all call those snaps, right? And right across the bottom there, she had a tattoo. And on that tattoo, it said, all eyes on me, I see you looking. Norby, that's what the tattoo said. She probably was barely 16 or 17. I wish one of my sisters would have come home like that. My mom would have beat them all the way back to the tattoo shop. And that's the problem that we have. The problem that we have is that we lack accountability. You know that? We lack accountability. Oh, this ain't anything goes. It's okay. He just sowing his wild oats. He just being himself. But what did I tell y'all earlier? The scripture says, train up a child in the way he should go. You train that child up in the way he should go. Guess what? You won't have those type of tattoos. You won't have those type of attitudes, all right? But see, the scripture is so ever true, and the scripture is so ever right. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse number 37, he tells us, he said, he who does what? Loves father or mother more than me is now worthy of me. Guess what? We're too concerned about what other people have to say. We have to have the mindset that we love God more than we love father or mother. He said he's not worthy of me. He who loves sons or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. We have to ask ourselves, are we worthy of God this morning? Are we worthy of Christ this morning? We must be willing to stand fast in God's word, even if it means that family has to come second. Y'all know that? Sometimes we won't put family second. Sometimes we won't put the children second. Sometimes we won't put anybody second. Why? Because it's all about us. It's all about me, mine, I. And even the Apostle Paul, he understood that he should fear God and not man. And so we ought to have the same mindset that we have to do what? what? We'd rather obey and fear God than fear man. And so Paul tells Timothy, as we wrap this up, in 2 Timothy 3:12, he says, all who desire to live godly in Christ will suffer persecution. Your version may say, shall suffer persecution. So guess what? If you live in godly in Christ, trying to take a stand for Christ, folk ain't gonna like it. Everybody gonna have something to say. Everybody gonna have a commentary. But guess what, church? We need to please God. We may as well accept and expect trouble to come and be not surprised when it comes. In fact, it will be even worse and worse. So in 2 Timothy chapter 3, in verse 14 to 17, he gives us instructions on how to live successfully in this environment. The first thing that we ought to do is continue in God's truth, all right? The second thing that we ought to do is understand that the scripture will make us wise unto salvation. We understand that the inspired scriptures are a reliable source for our doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. And when we realize this, that we turn to the word of God, we'll have a better society. We need to understand that if we live by the instruction of God's word, we become mature Christians, fully able to do the work that God expects us to do. When children have no respect for parents, for adults, or for themselves, guess what's going to happen to them? Children, guess what's going to happen to you? Y'all want to know what's going to happen to you? What's going to happen to you is 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse number 23. It says something here. It says, as Elijah spake, he went up from this to Bethel, and as he was going up, by the way, there came forth little children out of the city, and they mocked him, and they said unto him, go up, thou bald-headed, go up, thou bald-headed. And he turned back, he looked at them, he cursed them in the name of the Lord, and there came two sheep-bears out of the wood, and they jammed 42 children of them. What am I saying here? I'm saying that when we have no respect for our parents, when we have no respect for God, when we have no respect for adults, when we have no respect for authority, when we have no respect for ourselves, nothing good is going to happen. Nothing good is going to happen. And it's time for us to get back to the basics. It's time for us to get back to the foundation of God's word. And when we do that, we'll know in times like these, what are God's children supposed to do?
Blessing us this evening. reminding us, what are we supposed to do when our young people have fallen victim to the vices of Satan? In Exodus, we read, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long. The implication is the opposite of that is. We thank you, Brother Williams, for blessing us. We certainly appreciate the gift that God has stirred in him to share that wonderful message with us this evening.
Yes.
Without further notice, we have coming before shortly a very seasoned gospel preacher. Almost 30 years of preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. He is certainly not new to many of us. We know that he has been doing great, great work at the Northeast Church of Christ in Grand Rapids, Michigan. He has been there since 1998. Amen. That's a long time to be sharing the gospel in one place these days, brother. So we know God's blessing. He has wife, Cynthia. He's been married 28 years. Amen. Four children. He is a Southwestern Christian College graduate. He's furthered his studies at SMU, Cornerstone University, and he is also a proud honoree of Midwestern Christian Institute with a doctorate degree. We know that there are also a list of other credits and credentials to his resume, but he said just that's good enough. He's just ready to preach God's word, amen. And I believe our ears have been primed up, Brother Kevin, to feast upon the word of God. The very next voice you will hear will be that of Dr. Norvi Cottingham from the Northeast Church of Christ.
No pilgrim, no stranger, a beggar I be, as here I go traveling on. Though dearest of friends will not listen to me and chide me from trusting God's Son.
Should I say the newly renamed Dr. James E. Thompson. What a wonderful, deservedly honor to have someone has said that streets are not just ways of getting your mail delivered, but people invest a great deal in street identity. Change the street name, and you change the way people think about that city. You see, the thought was, ideology is where, or this is where ideology meets the asphalt. And so, when I heard that, I thought it was true, but when I looked at Dr. Thompson, I said, let me adapt. It's more than ideology meeting asphalt when the name of the street changes.
Well,
but it's where, knowing Dr. Thompson, where theology meets anthropology, sociology, and psychology. For that's what we call the study of man. His ministry and his legacy will continue to live on and on. And I think that's a wonderful honor. God bless you. Bring you greetings from the Eastern Avenue Church of Christ in the great city of Grand Rapids, Michigan, on the west coast of our fair state.
Yes, sir.
It's just so good to be asked to be here again, and I feel very honored to be have a small part of your lectureship and your homecoming weekend or week. Didn't Dr. Williams do a great job?
Yeah.
I see him all the time. I call him the hardest working man in the pulpit. And if you heard him tonight, now you know why Franklin Street is so blessed. My topic is entitled, When Shacking Up Overrides the Sacred Purity of marriage.
All right.
Just for a moment, allow me to take your minds on a spiritual book tour review of 1 Timothy, the first four chapters of 1 Timothy. I want to take you back to the first century, before the television was invented, before the airplane was flown, and before we ever thought of an internet. I want to take you back to the first century, to the gateway of ancient Asia, to a geographical location that had the indelible distinction as being both the highway to Rome and the highway of the martyrs at the same time. I want to take you to a place called Ephesus, a place with a population of nearly 300,000 souls that was known for its theaters, its library, and its immorality surrounding that temple named Diana. Now, this begs the question, was Ephesus an easy place to develop a church of our Lord? No, it wasn't easy. But really, are there any easy places in the world where men love darkness rather than light? Next, I'd like to introduce to you a young man named Timothy. He was the gospel preacher in Ephesus. But when we look at the text, there were implications that Timothy may have considered leaving Ephesus instead of living there. Although much can be said about that, the pivotal point that I want to point out is that while Timothy may have been bent on leaving Ephesus, the Apostle Paul saw the benefits of Timothy staying in Ephesus. Look at the neighbor and say, neighbor, should I stay, or should I go? So the Apostle Paul writes him a letter called 1 Timothy, chapter 1, a good warfare, meaning fight the good fight of faith. Chapter 2, Paul reminded Timothy that worship is a service and not a circus. Meaning that true worship is not spectating like a thing, but is participating like a saint that has been seen. Chapter 3, service is demonstrated through the episcopos and the diakonos. That is the spiritual work of the bishop and of the deacon. And then, while still in chapter 3, the Apostle Paul smoothly infuses his purpose for writing this letter. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 3:15, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of the truth. Let me just pause here to say that Paul wrote Timothy to tell him not only how he should behave, but how everybody else ought to behave in the church. Now let me remind you that the church is not the steeple. It's the people. This is how people ought to behave in God's house. And every now and then while I'm alone here, we need to tell people how to behave themselves. When you refuse to forgive and release, somebody needs to tell you how to behave yourself. When the fellowship that we have is chilly and cold instead of warming your soul, somebody needs to tell you how to behave yourself. When the marriage count is getting lower while the divorce count climbs higher, somebody, y'all quiet tonight, but somebody ought to tell you how to behave yourself. Respect God when you're in his house. Mind your manners when you're in his house. And remember that he owns you and you are not your own. A word to the young people before you go to the club. You ought to speak to the owner. God is the owner. Before you take that drink, you ought to speak to the owner. God is the owner. Before you choose a date, you ought to take the time and speak to the owner. God is the owner. Before you lock your lips with another, somebody ought to say, you better speak to the owner. And somebody in the wrong place might hear that it ain't nothing wrong with a little bump and grind. But I'll tell you, before you bump and the grind, you better speak to the owner. Because God is the owner. And you are not your own. My brothers and my sisters, when we look at our text, there was some spiritually negative behavior in Ephesus. And this behavior was at an epidemic all-time high. And the Apostle Paul was concerned that the influence of the city would infiltrate the church with its spiritually weakening common confession. Now I want to know that the world has some common confessions. The world has some sayings that they all agree with. The world has some sayings. Somebody says, well, when you look at Ephesus, what was a common saying? The Bible tells me in Acts chapter 19 and verse number 28, that there was a common saying saturating the city of if you will, professions or confessions, and look unto Jesus, who is the author and effecter of our faith. The Bible says here that Paul is asserting that godly living is living in Christ. We ought to live like Christ and sacrifice our life. I know that sounds strange, but weary pilgrims are happier when they live like Christ and sacrifice their life. Somebody says, what do you mean, weary pilgrims? Well, maybe I'm older than I look, but when I was a kid, we used to sing the song, I'm just a weary pilgrim flying through this world of sin, getting ready for that city. What did they say? When the saints go marching in. Why do we study? Because I want to be with the sacred saints when they march on in. Why then do we sing and pray? Because I want to get ready when the saints go marching in. Why are you here tonight? It ought to be. That you want to be ready when the saints go marching in. What was your point? Live like Christ and sacrifice your life. And if you live by that, that is for him. And if you live by that principle, it doesn't matter what the subject is. He is your Lord. You deny yourself. He's your master. He's in control. And you don't worry about the storm or the waves on the sea. Because he is the master that says, peace, be still. So as we converge with chapter 4, we find that there is a word that crops up from background study. And this word is called asceticism. Asceticism, and you may not have to say it so it doesn't sound like such a big word. Who's the next say, neighbor? The preacher's talking about?
The preacher's talking about.
Asceticism.
Asceticism.
Now, asceticism is the abstinent lifestyle of refraining from worldly pleasures. And asceticism has infiltrated the church of my Lord. Now, I know that's right because apostasy, which is a falling away from the truth, has shipwrecked the faith of some. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 119. I know that this is true, that his asceticism had infiltrated the church because seducing spirits had led Hymenaeus and Alexander to blaspheme. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 20. I know that asceticism, which is the abstinent lifestyle of refraining from worldly pleasures, had infiltrated the church because some had seared conscience, meaning that they had no sense between what was right and wrong. If you live long enough, it sounds like you're talking about today. But when you study the good book, we realize that nothing is new under the sun. And whenever God is not the king of your life, then you'll do as it did in the day of judgment. Every man did what was right in his own eyes. Now, as I look at the text, I know that asceticism has infiltrated the church because the Holy Spirit has said that it is true. The Bible says, now the Spirit speaking expressly, that the latter time some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, and having a conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry. I'll stop there because that's where I'm supposed to be. You see, asceticism was telling individuals that they didn't have to be married. And it sounds like that's what's going on in the world today. There's a lot of people who act like that they don't have to get married, but they can live any way that they want to. First of all, they tell every child of God that if you have been baptized in the watery grave of baptism, You're married already. For you are married to Christ. And he dictates how you think, how you act, what you say, and where you go. We see that in the first century, we find that there was a human precept of forbidding to marry. It was discouraged in the first century, but it's being also done today. And we see it when the term shacking up is used. Now, my topic is that when shacking up overrides the sanctity or the purity of marriage, that to override means to cancel or reject a decision. Anytime you disagree with God, you are trying to override what he said.
Yes.
Jesus says, he that rejected me and received not my word, and one that will judge him. Why would one reject the counsel of Jesus? Why would one receive not the word of Jesus? It's because he or she is trying to override what God has already ruled upon. Let me give you some working definitions. The word or the phrase shacking up is also called cohabitation. It is also called living together and civil partnerships. Shacking up or cohabitation speaks to one's living arrangement. But I will tell you, no matter what you call it, it's still unholy. Some people call it stay over relationships in which they spend 3 or more nights together each week while still having the option to return to their home. But you can act like you're married, but if you're not, it's still unholy. There are at least 4 types of shacking up or reasons that lead to people shacking up. One is called the prenuptial, and that relates to those who live together before they get married, saying that they're trying to save some money. Next, you have those who live together because they want to test and see how compatible they are with one another. Thirdly, you have those who just happen to drift, just happen to fall into a relationship with somebody because they are trying to escape a bad family situation. Maybe the young lady was having trouble at home with her parents, and she didn't want them to tell her what to do any longer. So she runs away, but she runs to that man's house, and she finds herself shacking up. And then the fourth one that I will present, and there are many more, but the fourth one that I present is what we call the sequel to a failed marriage. In other words, somebody had been married before, but they got divorced. And the divorce got such a bad taste in their mouth, they said, I need companionship, but marriage never again. Some say that shacking up seems so innocent. But I will tell you, the infiltration is subtle and penetrating. You can say this by watching TV. When I was a kid, back in 1977, there was a show called Three's Company. I'm sure the first time you saw it, you was appalled. But the more they came on, the more you watched them. Even today, now it's The Bachelor. Let me add this one. Love and Hip Hop Atlanta. Some of y'all do watch that, don't you? You know about Jocelyn and Stevie J. Some say shacking up is so innocent. Well, let me give you a picture of how it starts. Jack and Jill meet and go on a date. Jack and Jill have casual sex. Jack spends a weekend at Jill's apartment. Next, Jack brings clothes, cologne, and soon the whole dresser to Jill's apartment. Then Jack and Jill begin making investments together, like buying groceries for a refrigerator and gas for a car. And before you know it, Jack begins to think, if she can wash my clothes, cook my meals, help pay the bills without me putting up bread on the freezer, why do I have to make a commitment? Jack says, I've got a sex partner without a marital commitment. Jack says, I choose to avoid divorce and financial risk. In short, it sounds like Jack wants a house before he gets a wife. It's all messed up. You know, when I was looking at this, I said, you know, I got the wrong Jack and Jill. You know, the nursery rhyme got it better than they did. Jack and Jill, sitting in the tree, K-I-S-S-I-N-G. First comes love, then comes marriage, then comes the baby and the baby carriage. Shacking up is a performance-based relationship. If you don't perform well, then they say, I'm out of here. Someone has said, if you make me feel loved, then I'll marry you. If you satisfy me sexually, then I'll marry you. If you treat me with respect, then I'll marry you. If you make me happy, then I'll marry you. If you make something of yourself, then I'll marry you. If you fulfill my needs, then I'll marry you. If you like what I like, then I'll marry you. And then if you don't get on my nerves, even married folks say that, then I'll marry you. So much to be said and so vast. But what is the church to do? In times like these, what are God's children supposed to do? If it seems like the foundations are destroyed, what are the righteous supposed to do? Well, let God overrule your override. Realize that He is almighty and all powerful. Realize that His word will never pass away. And not only is it settled now in heaven, but His word was settled before the foundation of the world. Before there was an Adam and an Eve, the word was settled. Before there was a you or me, the word was settled. He says marriage is honorable in all. He met a woman in John chapter 4. And he says to the woman, he says, go get your husband. Whenever Jesus tells you to do something, you better be honest. At least this woman was honest. She says, I have no husband. He says, you tell the truth because you've had five. And the one you're with, are you with somebody that's not yours?
Let God overrule your overrides. Whatever we read or whenever we read the text, what God has joined together. Now, I'm not going to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. God didn't join Eve and Steve. He joined male and female, Adam and Eve. We've got to say it in love. We got to build bridges so people don't think that we're so mean. You know, like a little kid walked around and nobody shook his hand. He called everybody Mr. Meanie. Well, we don't want to be Mr. Meanie. We got to speak the truth in love. We got to learn how to talk to people. We got to pray for the tongue of the learned. God will give it to us. But the thing I'm trying to get to you is that when Jesus speaks, we need to tell the truth and just be honest. When he says that it's not yours, I know I got off there, but when he says it's not yours, it's time to leave. It's time to leave. And I hope nobody here tonight is in that kind of situation. But if you are, it's time to leave. But he loves me. It's time to leave. She wants my clothes. What does it profit a man? Gains the whole world. But she called me Mr. Big Stuff. And lose your soul. Have we forgotten that's what got Samson in trouble? He thought he was Mr. Big Stuff. Because every time the Philistines came around, he could have shake them off. But one day, Mr. Big Stuff found out he wasn't that big after all. Because whenever you reject God, whenever you deny God, his spirit leaves you. And he starts playing around with Delilah. And you know the Delilahs of the world will tell you everything that you want to hear. But he was with a woman that was not his. And she turned on him. Don't think that if you have in an improper, non-scripture relationship, that person won't turn on you. What makes you think they won't turn on you? If they won't make a permanent commitment, why wouldn't they turn on you? Oh, so much I could say here. Where's my time? Okay, I got 6 minutes. Okay. Let me just say that when it comes to those type of lifestyles, it's best just to run as quick as you can. It seems alluring. You want to assert your individuality, but run as fast as you can. No doubt Paul dealt with situations like this, and he said, touch not, taste not. Y'all get that? Oh, we gotta say this together. That was too good. Let's try this together. 1, 2, 3. Touch not, taste not, handle not. Your son says, you know what? I think I'm gonna move in with so and so. Touch not, taste not, handle not. Your daughter says, but no, I think I'm old enough to make my own decisions. Touch not, taste not, handle not. Your best friend says, you know what? I think he really loves me, and he said that if it worked out, he might marry me. Touch not, taste not. As I move to a conclusion, there are many people who are just struggling with love. And they're kind of like the question that was raised in Jeremiah. Is there any word from the Lord? And if you've had more downs than ups, you want to know, is there any word from the Lord? If you're having a tough time, you need to know, is there any word from the Lord? begin attacking, you need to know, is there any word from the Lord? In times like these, what are God's children supposed to do? Raise the question, is there any word? Is he aware?
Now, I already know. No, Broadway knows the answer because y'all just sung the song. I know. Somebody's listening.
Mm-hmm.
And hear everything I say.
We ought to be like that writer. That song writer. The psalmist who said, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand there in the way of sinners, nor sit up in the seat of the scornful, but his delight. What turns him on? What motivates him? What gets him going? What wakes him up and starts him on his way? His delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. Always available.
Somebody has said, and I must adapt this, drifting on a memory. Ain't no place I'd rather be than with you, loving you. Every child of God ought to be saying, I want to be living for the love of you, because I delight in the word both day and night. I want to be living for the great delight. All that I'm giving is for the great delight. I'll give up loose living for the great delight. I'll give up backbiting for the great delight. I'll give up drinking and smoking for the great delight. I'll deny myself and all my earthly possessions to follow the great delight. I'll stop shacking up. I better say that again. I'll stop shacking up when I'm not married for the great delight. I'll start reading my Bible and consecrating on his word, for he my great delight. I keep on trusting him more and more because he's my great delight. And sometimes when it's hard to tell the night from day, I rest assured that he's still my great delight. Though the waves and the currents seem so fierce, he's still my great delight. And even if the storms don't cease, he's still my great delight. The winds may keep blowing, but he's still my great delight. You may not like me, but he's still my great delight. You might not shake my hand, but he's still my great delight. I might miss that promotion, but he's still my great delight. No man or no woman may ever tell you I do, but he still ought to be your great delight. When shacking overrides the sacred purity of marriage, the church is in trouble. We need people who will stand up and show the church and the world how to behave. I'm not sure which one of these go down.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. All right. If there's someone here tonight that would like to give their life to the Lord, you ought to do it.
I'll do it today.
Now, God didn't give us the breath in our bodies, allow us to put pep in our step and to assemble here and hear all this good singing and praying and hear his word and then not want to say it. If you are lost, we have a Savior who seeks to save. He's seeking right now. His word is penetrating your heart. What you got to do is let it have root. Let that engrafted word save your soul. Realize that you need the word. Because it is the food for the spiritual man. We have two warring factors in our lives. We have the old man, and we have the new man. The old man wants to live. The new man wants to live. The old man knows he lives when he has lust, vices, and all the sinful cravings that he desires. The new man knows that he lives when he has the fruit of the Spirit rest, ruling, and abiding in his life. The Bible says that they both cannot exist in you at the same time because they are contrary one to another. So as we extend this invitation, realize that there's a battle going on in your mind. The old man is going to give you every excuse not to give your life to the Lord. The old man is going to tell you that you can put it off. But the Bible says the day you hear his voice, harden not your heart. I'm so glad to serve a Lord who has a word that softens the hungry soul. If there's one here that's not a member of the body of Christ, then please know, Christ is the answer. Amen. He's the only answer. Yes. And he put it this way. He says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father, where is he in heaven? In other words, you can't get to heaven unless you go through him. So we preach Christ and him crucified. He is the Savior. For the world from sin. So, he heard, come to him by hearing, believing that he is, repenting of your sins, that means you got to change, confessing his name, acknowledge that he is your master, and then being buried in the watery grave of baptism, where God will operate on you, where the old man will be destroyed, and where you will receive the indwelling measure of Holy Spirit, and you can arise to walk in the newness of life. If that be your hope, please come together and stand and sing a song of encouragement.
There are some things that I may not know.
we truly have been blessed tonight. Just appreciate both of our speakers tonight. We got two more nights. All I can say is we truly have been blessed. We just appreciate the effort that's been put forth by everyone from Sunday through tonight. We just trust and pray that you will continue to come out and lend your support and invite others. But truly, the world needs to hear the message. I have a few responses I'm going to do these, so if you can go on, I just need to do a couple other things and some other announcements that need to be made. Just before we dismissed as well, I know Dr. Thompson's got some things too. The prayer requests we had. First one from Sister Charlene Kelly is requesting prayer for her health. Not feeling her best today, but God has blessed her to be here, and also requesting prayer for the health of her husband, Bobby. Church, we definitely need to pray. Look at these requests. There's other things too. Sister Lori Andrews has requesting prayer for her sister Diane Clark. She is in the hospital and they are running tests. So I pray that everything will work out favorably for her. Then Brother Douglas Sims is requesting prayer for himself and his family. And the message is his brother was removed from life support this afternoon. Brother Douglas Sims' brother was removed from life support this afternoon. So we truly want to remember that family in our prayers. Also, it got word Sister Beverly Hamilton and her daughter, they would not be here. I got this message after was here, but they were just finishing up coming from, I think it was the hospital, doctor's office, whatever. So with, you know, tests and different things they're going over, so pray for them as well. Also, did get a chance to talk to Brother Bunty. He had one procedure, and he has another one coming up this week, so we will remember to keep him in our prayers. And there was someone else who was having a procedure. We can't remember everybody right now, but just need to pray for one another. And then we want to remember to pray for all who are on our prayer list, and also all those regarding travel. We thank both our speakers. We want to pray for them that they have safe travel back. Our speakers for tomorrow, and also that Brother Solomon will be leaving us, him and his wife, tomorrow morning going back to Dayton. So we want to pray that they will have a safe trip back too. So, this time, let us pray on behalf of all of these that we have at this time. Lord our God, we just so are thankful for your messengers this evening and for you crowning their heads with wisdom. We just thank thee for the gift, the talents that you have given them to be able to deliver your word. We just are thankful for everyone that came out tonight. And first of all, you blessed us to arrive here safely. You looked over us and kept us safe. And to hear such powerful words that we can allow it to sink deep into our minds. And as was talked about, that we can meditate upon it day and night. And we also realize how blessed we are. We pray now regarding the requests that have been made. Sister Kelly for herself and for her husband regarding their health. Sister Lori Andrews' request for Sister Clark for her health and for the situation there. We pray that whatever it might be that the doctors, nurses, whatever, that they can find out what it is and then treat it properly. And we pray for Mrs. Clark and members of her family. We pray for Brother Sims and the members of his family regarding the situation with his brother. We know it's got to be difficult times, and as it was talked about in the message, but we know you're in control. We just pray that we all can realize as We all go through the ups and downs that we look to thee for the answer. We pray for all those that are also requesting prayer for traveling grace, those who will be leaving us, some who will be coming back, members of this congregation who are away. And we just thank thee for keeping all safe. And we ask that you just keep your loving arms of protection around us as we go from even just down the street, realizing the world we live in today and how impatient people are and how quickly things can escalate. We ask that you continue to be with Dr. Thompson as he labors here with us, mentally, physically, and spiritually, the same with Dr. Brackett, and also with Dr. McGarity and the work that he does with our young people too. We ask that you just bless the young people of this congregation and throughout this land and country with all the things that they're faced with, that we can help them to be a light and to realize you have the answer, not the peers, not those who say they're friends, and not be overcome by peer pressure. We ask now that you just continue to be with us, and again, just want to say thank you for blessing us all to be here this evening. And we pray that as we will leave here shortly, that we can all arrive at our destination safely. It is in your Son Jesus' name that we do pray and give thanks. Let us say amen.
Amen.
First of all, it is too hot up there. I have an uncle, my wife's uncle, down in Florida, years ago asked me, Jim, do you sweat when you preach? I said, well, not then. But if you was in my church, you wouldn't get no pay. He said, a preacher has got to sweat. He said, you know, you got to earn by the sweat of your brow. And I thought tonight, I said, if Uncle B was here tonight, he would say, pay these men well. So I want to commend Brother Kevin Williams, Dr. Williams, and Dr. Cottingham. You are marvelous stars. Appreciate you. Then, of course, Brother Solomon stayed over to share with us today, tonight, and he too did a marvelous job. So we commend him. We commend all of our speakers, and of course, Donald Issa, Joseph Edwards, and Hugh Solomon, and Brother Dr. James Snow did great jobs. Thank the Lord. Our speaker for tomorrow evening is already here, all the way from Gadsden, Alabama. So glad to see the young man, Brother Norwood, in our audience tonight. He'll be speaking on tomorrow evening. Very qualified. So will Brother Professor Ali Merriweather. Ali Merriweather will be speaking as a professor from our school, Waterford Church of Christ, where he attends. And he'll be talking about the importance of Christian education. And he is qualified to do the job. Mm-hmm. Also, Dr. Anthony Norwood from Gaston, Alabama, will be speaking on the subject when the moral, domestic, and church affairs are accommodating. And we thank God for him. We know that we're in for a treat when these fine men come before us on tomorrow evening. We wish to welcome and thank each of you for coming. All of our sister congregations, preachers, church leaders, we are honored to have you. Glad to see the fine preachers from two brothers, twins. I don't know which one to call, but it's the Stewarts. The Stewarts. If I call him one, I get his name wrong. But we just love him to death. Honored to have them and all of the preachers who have come. We thank God for your presence. Wish to thank Brother Flack for having done such a marvelous job here tonight. Dr. Amir Bracken for the introductions that he gave. We just thank God for him. All of our men, all of who serves us, we thank God for you. So we'll turn the service into the hands of the one that is to give the benediction. We're going to ask you, first of all, I'm sorry, are there any announcements that any preachers or church leaders have that we should make here tonight? If not, then I'll turn the service into the hands of Brother. Yes. Yes, yes, please. And then afterwards, Brother. Yes, sir.
Just briefly, I invite all singles to our third Singles Weekend Experience. It's going to be November the 17th through the 19th, and it's going to be at Lake Geneva. And it's just for the singles. But we're going to have a great time. The theme is living at the mercy of others. Living at the mercy of others. So we will be sending information shortly, but I just want to make a public invitation to you. It's November the 17th through the 19th. Thank you.
As you're standing, just want to mention two things. Mostly to Broadway members, and there might be some who are from sister congregations too. The retirement banquet and everything is coming very soon for our minister, Dr. Thompson. So there's a note here for the church, family, and friends to remember that your retirement adds and money are due. Supposed to be due by July the 3rd, so we're already past that. So if you haven't done that, then you need to try and take care of that tonight. The book will be printed. I mean, the plan is that everything will be cut off by the end of this month, and everything done. So you can see Sister Crawley regarding that. Then the other thing we're just going to mention is just think of all the prayer regarding people being sick and everything. This morning, what we want to do, we want to wish Sister Dora Walker. Her birthday will be tomorrow. Is it today? Okay, I thought this said Wednesday. Today is Tuesday, but this said Wednesday, I thought. Okay, so we want to wish her happy birthday today. It's a blessing to have a birthday and to be here on this side. So then we want to wish her happy birthday. So this time, the fact that you're giving us verse of song, and then Elder Henry will be giving us our dismissal prayer.
Everything's gonna be alright when Jesus comes over. Everything is gonna be alright when my Jesus.
at this time here. You might say the house full, and thank God you were here that you can preach on something that has been shared today. Some other ones that helped them along the way. We just thank God for your traveling grace and you have a safe arrival back to your destination, and also for all the plans that have been taking place here this week. Continue our best up on our sick and shedding of those in the hospital. I think we read a couple of them a little while ago, and just remember those, and you may know of others. And we'll thank God for the speakers. And what they have brought to us, and these people don't need to keep them to love. The Lord our God, our Father, which art in heaven, we come giving you thanks for your pleasure, that you have blessed us and be able to assemble ourselves again for your word of being taught, and we can teach others also. Continue our blessing upon those that are sick and shut in, and those that are not able to be with us. And be with those that it is still in bereavement, if God will, and those that are traveling, wherever they may be headed back, give them traveling grace to their destination. And we just thank God for the speakers of this hour and the hours in the past have been made, and for all of them that have traveled far and near to be here to teach that word. And bless us all, Heavenly Father, that we try to be what you have us to be, that we can teach others also. Let us give thanks, amen, to God at this time. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If we could, amen.